Hello everyone, I'm Norman Walberger. Thanks for joining me on this adventure. I'm trying to give you some advice in the direction of doing amateur research mathematics. And I'm going to be talking in a sort of philosophical fashion today. Now, you'll probably know that I'm not that philosophically inclined generally. I like things to be concrete, explicit, you know, on the page, and you know, abstract musings often I'm a little bit impatient with. But I think it's useful to give you some orientation, some large-scale orientation every now and then. That's what I'm proposing to do today, just to get you thinking about the structure of pure mathematics in a very general kind of way. So these are some insights that I've gained over my decades of doing mathematical research, and they're naturally very personal kind of insights, so maybe they're not shared by other mathematicians. But I'd like to get you thinking in terms of layers of complexity that, you know, we can start studying something simple. That's usually how we like to start. And then if we examine it, you know, from different points of view, we may find that it fits in into some larger framework, a larger pattern. There's another layer of the onion. So there's sort of these layers of the onion going out instead of going in, which is really interesting, something that we should look for. And very specifically, what I really want to do also is to move you from thinking about number theory in a sort of arithmetical point of view to moving to a polynumber point of view, which is sort of algebra, and ultimately to a bigger picture, a sort of a two-dimensional point of view involving maxels. So I'm going to touch base with maxels, which are my version of matrices, and I'll tell you a little bit about that as we go on, and I'll give you some references in the description. So there appears to be, in some sense, a general or rough principle that no matter what we're thinking about, typically we can look to embed our current investigation into some larger framework, often in more than one way. And so we get this hierarchy of increasingly interesting things. Now, there's a philosophical question here about whether this increasing complexity just carries on. I mean, certainly at our level, it appears to sort of ascend, you know, above and beyond our view. But whether the actual intrinsic nature of mathematics is such that it keeps on going, or whether it somehow sort of closes up, you know, at some point, that's an interesting question. So it may, in fact, be that there's some bound that sort of limits the possible complexity of what's happening. That might be connected to, you know, physical bounds in the universe. After all, if you want to write things down explicitly and concretely, then the amount of space and the amount of material in the physical world is going to constrain you, obviously, right? So it may be that the physical world actually also imposes limitations on the mathematical world. That's an interesting view. We don't know, okay, but I think we should keep our minds open to possibilities like that. In fact, it might even be, though it's, you know, almost beyond our comprehension, but it might be that there's some master mathematical theory, or if you like, a master mathematical formula that in some sense embraces all of other mathematics within it. Now, are we ever likely to be in a position to answer these questions? Probably not. You know, we're probably like rabbits, you know, trying to understand a modern aircraft carrier or something. But, okay, we can still ask the questions. And one of the aspects that I'm going to be talking about today is that, at least from our point of view, what we can think about is leapfrogging from objects to patterns to objects to patterns. So you have an object, you can put it into a pattern, and that pattern itself can then be considered as a new object, which may be just a constituent of some bigger pattern, okay? So patterns can create objects, objects can be arranged in patterns, and patterns can create objects, and there's some kind of general kind of leapfrogging that we're open to contemplating. So that's very general, okay, but in fact, what I more specifically want to do is to move you to think about number theory as a progression towards polynumber theory, and that's a progression to maxel theory, sort of a two-dimensional algebra. And I'm going to try to illustrate that today by looking at a very specific object, the number 28. Well, 28 is actually kind of an interesting number. Okay, it's 4 times 7. It's one more than 27, which is a cube. That's somewhat a little bit interesting. It also turns out to be a triangular number. And that's because if you take 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4 plus 5 plus 6 plus 7, okay, and evaluate that, you get 28. So a sum like that is called a triangular number. And the formula for it is that it's a formula. So you take 7 times 8 all over 2, okay? That's the same thing. So that's a triangular number. And of course, triangular numbers go back to the ancient Greeks. Here are the triangular numbers, and you see 28 appearing there. And there's a nice formula for it, which is basically this one here. So this is one way of thinking about the number 28, not as an individual thing, but as part of a pattern. It's part of the pattern of triangular numbers. Great. But, you know, things can be elements of lots of different patterns. And the number 28 is also an element of another important pattern, the pattern of perfect numbers. Here's the pattern for perfect numbers. That's 396 on Neil Sloan's online encyclopedia of integer sequences, which of course is a prime reference that we use all the time. Now, perfect number is one which is equal to the sum of the proper divisors of k. So you take all the divisors less than the number, add them all up, and if that's equal to the number, then the number is perfect. So the divisors of 6, which are less than 6, are 1, 2, and 3, and they add up to 6. The divisors of 28, which are less than 28, are 1, 2, 4, 7, and 14, and you add them up, you get 28. The next one's 496, the next one's 8,128, and then there's some bigger ones. And it was known even back to Euclid that there was some, you know, intimate and direct connection with these perfect numbers and so-called Mersenne primes. These are special primes of the form 2 to the n minus 1. And of course, famously, all the perfect numbers that are known are even, and we don't know whether there are any odd perfect numbers. That's a famous problem. So 28 is also in this family, but you'd have to say that this family is a lot more subtle and hard to get your head around than the triangular numbers, which are pretty straightforward. There's a nice clean formula for them, and the perfect numbers are much more complicated. Okay, so there's another way of thinking about 28, which comes about by looking at the binomial coefficients. If we take 1 plus x to the 8, okay, and we expand that out, we get this sequence here. 1 plus 8x plus 28x squared plus 56x cubed plus 70x to the fourth. So we get the binomial coefficients that you will have seen probably many times. And notably, 28 appears there. It also, in fact, appears here because it's always symmetrical. So 28 is appearing as a binomial coefficient. In fact, that's not a surprise because the triangular numbers are binomial coefficients. So this allows us now to illustrate what I'm trying to get at, is that once we have a pattern, we can think of a pattern as being an object. Okay, so this pattern of binomial coefficients, this is another way of sort of embedding 28 into a pattern. But the pattern now is not an ongoing pattern like the triangular numbers, but it's rather a very finite, specific pattern, starting with 1, 8, 28, 56, 70, 56, 28, 8, and 1. So it goes up and down. And once we've done that, then we can sort of think of that as being an object, and then we can think about positioning that object in a context of similar objects, right? So the one obvious way to do that is to relate this power of 1 plus x to other powers of 1 plus x. Okay, this is just the n equals 8 case of the more general binomial expansion of 1 plus x to the n. Now, once we've done that, what we're really doing here is making a move from one-dimensional kind of algebra. This is like a one-dimensional thing. It's a polynomial or a polynumber, okay? Which the way I like to think about a polynumber, as you know, is as a vertical list, or perhaps sometimes a horizontal list of coefficients. It's really the coefficients here that determines this object. That list of coefficients is, in some sense, the object. And so now what we can do is we can position that particular list in conjunction with related lists. And when we do that, we get sort of a list of lists or a family of lists, which is really a two-dimensional object. And I want to emphasize the interest in thinking about this and trying to take some one-dimensional situation and expanding it into a two-dimensional situation. It's a very, very fruitful kind of general thing to think about. So how can we do that? Well, here I've done it, okay? I've put the 1 plus x to the 8 coefficients in a row right there. And that's just the sort of the eighth row of the various rows that are appearing here. These are just all the rows of the Pascal triangle. In fact, this is the Pascal triangle written as a matrix. And when we think about it that way, we can think about it as the matrix P, P representing the Pascal matrix, because the rows are the entries of the powers of 1 plus x to the n. On the other hand, if you've taken the Algebraic Calculus 1 course, or you're taking it, you will know that this configuration is very important for a different reason, because the columns are arguably equally as important as the rows, even though their nature is very different. So the columns here, I call the Harriot sort of basis sequences. And starting with just the constant column of ones, and then here are just the numbers. And then here are the triangular numbers that we've already seen. And we see 28 appearing here. And then the next ones are the pyramidal numbers that you get by sort of stacking cannonballs in a three-dimensional pyramid. One, and then three in the base, and then one on top, that's four, and then six in the bottom, and then three, and then one, that's 10, etc. And then higher dimensional analogs of that. So, of course, this is just a snapshot of this array, which actually keeps on going. And I prefer to frame all these things in the language of maxels, which is a more data-theoretic sort of approach to matrices, where the actual size of the array is not really that crucial. What's really crucial are the multiplicities with which these entries appear. Okay, so ultimately we end up thinking about such an object as really a multi-set, okay, a multi-set of pixels. So that turns out to be a very powerful and pleasant way of thinking. All right, great. So now we have this two-dimensional extension of our, in fact, two different one-dimensional views of the number 28 positioned. Right. So here is 28 in the column of triangular numbers. That was one interpretation of 28. And here is 28 also in this row of the binomial coefficients involved in the expansion of 1 plus x to the 8. Now, once we have this two-dimensional array, we make contact with the algebra of maxels. So there's something special that happens in two dimensions. And it's all having to do with the algebraic structure of matrices or maxels, as I prefer. And the key operation there that we have that's sort of interesting is matrix multiplication. Okay, so addition is just sort of pointwise. That's not particularly novel, but the multiplication is something that's special that just happens in this two-dimensional situation in the way it does. And that's manifested in a lot of ways, but in linear algebra, what it amounts to is that this problem of taking inverses of matrices looms as almost essentially the central problem of linear algebra. And once we have such a thing, so I think I've defined H, let me just check. Okay, so this matrix H is this thing here. Now, of course, this is just going down to the row 9, but in principle, you know, this array can be extended. Okay, it just sort of keeps on going. Now, we're only able to view a top left corner of this ongoing array, but that, and we could do, you know, arithmetic with that. So let's have a look at this H, and I want to point out a really interesting fact. So an amazing fact, okay, that will not be a surprise to you if you've taken the Algebraic Calculus 1 course. Let's calculate the inverse of this matrix, okay? So given a matrix, a square matrix, probably one of the first things you want to know is it invertible or not? That's a question of the determinant. The determinant here is just the product of the diagonal elements, that's going to be 1. But the inverse of the matrix is really an interesting object almost all the time. So let's calculate H inverse. So there it is. And usually the inverse of a matrix is a complicated thing and not obviously connected to the original matrix. But we see here something really quite remarkable, okay? That the inverse of the matrix H is almost the same as H itself, except that there are some minus ones selectively put along these sort of diagonals going down from the main diagonal. So this first sort of subdiagonal has minus ones, and then the third one does, and then the fifth one does, and all the odd subdiagonals get minus ones. And otherwise, the entries are exactly the same as H. So, of course, this is it can be phrased in terms of an identity involving binomial coefficients, but it really sort of lives at the level of this two-dimensional matrix algebra. And it's a remarkable fact, and it's telling us that it's a good thing to think about this two-dimensional point of view. To think about this H as an object like this is a useful and pleasant thing to do, and you can tell that because the inverse is so remarkable. Okay, that's sort of an extra clue that we're onto a good thing. And we're going to see that this approach of extending our algebra from a one-dimensional situation to a two-dimensional situation and then touching base with the algebra of matrices, or better yet, maxels, is a really empowering kind of a general principle. And I'm going to be wanting to illustrate that principle to you by going back to some of those interesting families of polynomials that we looked at before.